anarcho-feminist in 1971, when she explicitly raised and answered the question of the meaningful using of the anarcho-feminist denomination. I quote, "Since anarcho-feminist primary commitment is and should be made to the radical feminist movement with only marginal participation in anarchist movement politics, does the term anarcho-feminist possess any functional significance, or is it only a confusing label laden with semantic difficulties? My own feeling is that the defining distinction from radical feminist to anarcho-feminist is largely that of making a step in self-conscious theoretical development. Having perceived that there are natural anarchist tendencies in the women's movement, an anarcho-feminist is one who intellectually identifies with major aspects of the intellectual tradition of anarchist radicalism." End of the quote. In this view, anarchism became not much more than the explicit conscious expression of the unconscious anarchist nature of radical feminism. In this perspective, an autonomous anarchist elaboration on the nature of male power became redundant, as the theorizations of patriarchy articulated by radical feminism were taken at face value, the problem now becoming how, through the development of its critique into a more general critique of power per se, to realize their revolutionary potential. Moreover, this perspective revealed a fundamentally, to my mind, enlightening approach to political and social struggle. For anarcho-feminists were meant to play the role of the conscious expression of an unconscious natural impulse, that is, of someone who was supposed to explain to the feminist movement what the feminist movement really thought. Some 20 years later, in a polemical essay on Kornegger's and Farrow's article, Susan Brown underlined how their optimist and simplifying view had not only been contradicted by the following development of feminist movement, but itself relied on a fundamental disregard of the plurality of feminist perspectives. I would go one step further and suggest this theoretical and political overlap relied on a fundamental misunderstanding about the nature of the motivations of the radical feminist critique of male power. This misunderstanding was made possible by a certain fetishism of the social and of organizational forms that led anarchist feminists to mistake the political content of radical feminism. While these anarcho-feminist authors saw in radical feminism the seeds of a general opposition to all forms of power and domination as oppressing and disfiguring human nature, they overlooked the fact that it was rather the demand to empower a specific subject, which was constituting itself through a discourse of difference and separation, that was finding expression in it. In other words, even if it is true that consciousness-raising, project-focused, small-size groups, combined with a critique of male hierarchies, showed some similarity with anarchist concerns about the consistency between means and ends, the other side of the coin is that these practices were part of a project of creating and empowering women as a new subject, rather than of questioning domination and power per se. From a theoretical point of view, this has been overlooked because of the application of a general and simplistic equation. As specifically male power and male domination are species of the genus power and domination, so too is the feminist movement a species of the general movement against all forms of power and domination. Simply put, the task of the anarcho-feminist would be just making this genus-species relation explicit. And I arrive to the third part and conclusion. Several decades later, the few more recent anarcho-feminist writings which have been produced show a much more critical approach to the experience of radical feminism and to its evolution. However, the impressive flourishing of gender theories of the last 30 years raises the question of what the specific theoretical space for anarcho-feminists should be. The definition of this specific space, in fact, would imply a new, less simplistic exchange with an analysis of the current trends in feminist and gender theory. From the end of the 90s onwards, a few writings have tried to deal with this issue, confronting in particular ecofeminism, materialist feminism, and queer theory. Among the most accomplished attempts in this sense is Chaya Heller's book Ecology of Everyday Life, published in 1999. Whereas Heller does insist on the presence of an anarchist impulse, both in the feminists of the 60s and 70s and in the emergence of ecofeminist activism in the 80s, she also points out their limits. In particular, she criticizes the ecofeminist tendency to abstraction and its romanticizing both nature in general and women's nature in particular, the tendency to an individualist account of subjectivity, the increasing absence of a critique of capitalism and of the state, and with a few exceptions, the erasure of the question of race. Starting from this critical appraisal, Heller tries to delineate the grounds for a new anarchist ecofeminist perspective. The value of this project lies, to my mind, in its refusal to resort to a romantic or nostalgic view of nature and to a standard opposition of spirituality and rationality. Heller rather insists on the possibility of building an anarcho-feminist ecofeminism on the phenomenology of what she calls socio-erotic, i.e., a spectrum of social desires oriented toward collectivity, sensuality, and non-hierarchy, which are not opposed to rationality, but are, on the contrary, rationally informed. According to Heller, the dichotomy between rationality and spirituality, which informs large part of ecofeminist theory, and the equation between what is rich, deep, and meaningful with what is not rational, fails to take into account the possibility of using reason in order to create structures and ways of life in which social desires can find a meaningful and cooperative expression. For Heller, these social desires are rooted in human nature understood in its sociality. Desires are the product of the social life of human beings, but at the same time affect in a dialectic relation between individuality and society the form of sociality. Whereas Heller refuses to rely on a simplistic view of the goodness of human nature, insisting that human nature entails both the impulse to sociality and its opposite, she does resort to the idea of human nature and of its potentialities in order to ground her notion of social desire. As in traditional anarchism, human nature remains, also for Heller, a resource of resistance to social power relations. The resort to the notion of human nature, however, is among the crucial assumptions anarcho-feminist needs to challenge today in the light of the radical questioning of such a presupposition by materialist feminism and queer theory. As I tried to show, the idea that the relations of exploitation and domination prevent women from realizing themselves as full human beings is at the core of the first anarchist critiques of women's oppression. But should this idea still be at the core of anarcho-feminist today? Should the task of anarcho-feminist be gendering the notion of human nature, or rather moving beyond this very idea? This question is particularly compelling, as both materialist feminism and queer theory have challenged the idea of any natural basis for the division of sexes, arguing that gender as a social construct precedes and causes the sexed body. The point, therefore, is not developing a notion of human nature capable of including the specificity of gender and sex, but rather renouncing human nature as both the grounds for a feminist critique of women's oppression and the source of a politics of liberation. This problem is debated in the very recent monographic issue of the journal Refraction, The Feminism en Vêtue en Voilà, which confronts the anarchist tradition, particularly anarcho-communism and anarcho-syndicalism, with contemporary feminist theories. Whereas all its articles share common perspectives concerning the critique of individualist anarchism, the centrality of class exploitation, and its relation to race and gender oppression, the collective strategies of women's emancipation and their bond with other collective struggles, the appraisal of the contribution of deconstructionism to feminist theory looks much more problematic. In any case, this debate, although still very embryonic, shows a willingness to theoretically deal with issues as fundamental as the role of nature in women's oppression, the relation between different systems of domination, and the role of the interaction between class, gender, and race in the processes of subjectivation and the strategies for collective liberation. This marks, and I conclude, a fundamental difference from the anarcho-feminist writings of the 70s, which, as I tried to show, in most cases confine themselves to reminding the feminist movement, and particularly radical feminism, of the necessity of bringing the struggle against gender oppression to the more general struggle against domination.